You may be seated. Take your Bibles and turn to John chapter 20, verses 20 through 24. John chapter 20, verses 20 through 24. Okay, I'm going to set a stage for a little bit to get us going for our sermon this morning. We have been doing a series the last 5 or 6 weeks. We started right after spring break ended. John Turner opened us up that Sunday morning with a very important thought. And that is that you and I will not be ashamed of that which we believe, which is Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. In the culture in which we now live in, it is going to take more courage to be able to stand for that which is truth than there has ever been before. And when the Apostle Paul wrote in Romans 1:16, I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ Jesus, that was within a Roman culture in which everything had collapsed. And yet he was willing to stand brave and tall and be able to preach very strongly that Christ is the answer. And he was not ashamed to do that. In fact, what we began our series with was a trip that Jesus took his disciples on. He took them from the Sea of Galilee up quite a distance north into Caesarea Philippi. On that particular Sunday a few weeks ago, I showed you the gates of hell. It's a literal place. It is in Caesarea Philippi. It's where they worship the god Pan. And there's where they worship and do their sacrifices and their temple prostitutes and their sacrificing of children. And Jesus brought them there, and there's a spot right next to where the Jordan River begins around that area in which they would have been sitting there looking at this cave. And that's literally what it is. It was a cave, and it's called the Gates of Hell. And Jesus is letting them know something. He says to Peter, who do men say that I am? And you have the first time that it's dawning on the disciples who Christ is. You're the Messiah, the Son of the living God. And Jesus very clearly said to him, this has been revealed to you by the Father in heaven. And he says, Peter, upon this rock, and he called Peter with the name Small Rock, but upon this rock, the big rock, which is the confession that Jesus is the Messiah, I will build my church and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. The culture, the Roman beliefs, all that was wrong within that culture. Nothing would stop the church from what it was going to do. And we've seen the history of that. It literally pervaded through the land decade after decade in the most powerful of ways. We then move the next week up to Mount Tabor. At Mount Tabor is where they think that Jesus did the Mount of Transfigurations. And they work their way up there, and three of the guys get to go up and watch what's about to unfold. And in the most stunning way, Jesus is standing there white like no launderer could ever make anything white in their life. And the disciple Peter looks up and sees Elijah and Moses. I still think it's unbelievable that he figured out who they were since there was no pictures of them. You couldn't Google that and bring up a picture of what Moses looked like or Elijah looked like, but he knew. But a very powerful statement was said at that particular point. It had been said before, but not like it was said that day. This is my beloved son. That was said at the baptism. But this time, the Father in heaven said, listen to him. Pay attention. Hear what he's got to say. It was at that moment, and this powerfully impacts Peter. His entire letter that he writes later on is centered around this impactful day when he was up there and saw Jesus glorified. It changed who he was after the resurrection of Christ. And that's one of the areas he kept going back to in his thoughts. Because that's how powerful that particular moment was. So you have back-to-back moments when Peter knows who he is, now when he sees him. But what amazes me is human nature. We can have all these great truths right in front of us. And what did the disciples do next as they were walking? They get in a discussion about who is the greatest. I am better than you. No, I am better than you. They got in an argument over this. Maybe after seeing Jesus in glory, and they think, okay, this Messiah guy has really got power, and I want to be Secretary of State. I want to be head of Homeland Security. Whatever their positions they were vying for, I am better than you discussion. Jesus, aware of the discussion, looks at them and says to them, what you talking about, guys? And like little children caught with their hand in the cookie jar, nobody can say a word. Not a word. But Jesus brings home at that moment a very profound truth about life. And it is one of the most profound truths, and it's found throughout the New Testament over and over. And those who never learn this will never do well in life. And the truth is, you want to be great? Then you become everybody's servant. You humble yourself as I will humble myself. But greatness comes through being a servant of all men. It's a lesson very few people ever learn. But he tells his disciples that. Now they begin their road into Jerusalem during an entirely fascinating week that begins to unfold. Last week, we went to the cross now, and we looked last week that he's hanging there. And we remember three groups came to see him as he's hanging there on the cross at Golgotha. There's two major thoroughfares, one going this way, one going like this. Golgotha sits. The mountain itself is only about as high as from here to the top of the balcony right there. The face looks like a skull. Literally, if you look at it at a certain angle, you see the eyes, the nose, the mouth, and everything else. He's either hanging at the top or he's hanging at the base of it. They're not certain, but there he is. And the passerbyers who came by mocked him and they insulted him. The religious leaders who came by, they do not even acknowledge his presence, but they laugh at him and they mock him to each other. They never spoke to him. If you'll read the Greek, they never spoke to him. They spoke to each other because they would not give him the time of day. And on either side, the two thieves are just ranting and raving at him. Both did that, just pouring out in perfect tense, imperfect tense, their voice over and over. And these are men who can't hardly breathe, and yet the venom of their heart is spewing forth. And what did our Lord do as he hung on the cross from last week when we looked at that? He just stayed quiet. He never said a word. Like a sheep being led to a slaughter, he never said one word. You know, last week I spent quite a bit of time on that because we live in a culture, it's always been this way, but we live in a culture where we're always worried about what everybody else thinks about us, and we don't even handle the smallest little things and pressures that come our way. And yet he hung there. You know, sometimes you get your most profound thoughts. It may not be to you, but it was as I was leaving Sunday morning and going home, as I poured everything I knew into showing how Jesus handled that type of stuff, it dawned on me, when did he finally get to him? When did it finally? Because Jeremiah and Job, you remember last week, Jeremiah and Job had points where they finally couldn't handle it anymore. And they were going, you lied to me, God, or why'd you put me in here? And they couldn't handle it. The pressure of everything they were going through, the shame of all that was happening, finally got to them. When did it finally get to Jesus? In the darkness, after 3 hours, when he screamed out, my God, why have you forsaken me? You know what dawned on me as I was driving home last week? It never bothered him what everybody else was saying. It never even, I made it real hard. I don't think it, afterwards I'm going, it wasn't that hard for him then. It's hard because of how we think about it. But what got to him is the one person he wanted to be pleasing to, which was the Father in heaven. See, when you want the Father in heaven to be pleased with who you are, when that's the most important thing within your life, then what others say does not matter. And their impact and their influence will not stop you from being what you ought to be. But there came that moment that Jesus breathed his last, and we saw last week as we closed the sermon, the Roman centurion sat there watching that entire thing and how he handled it and how he died. I don't know if you've ever watched anyone die. I've seen people killed in front of me. I've had people die in my presence on many occasions. And there is a godly way to die. I have seen it. Over and over and over again, I've seen it. But there is the way to die, and that's the way the Lord Jesus did, as he handled everything to such perfection. And he said, "Tetelestai, it is finished." And he breathed his last. And the Roman centurion looked at that and said, "This is the Son of God. This is the Son of God." But I wish that at that moment even the disciples would have understood that, but they didn't. So stand with me. You follow along in your Bible as I read. We're going to look at Thomas. We always call him Doubting Thomas. I don't use that anymore because all the disciples were doubting. None of them handled it correctly. Thomas was just late to the party, and so he gets singled out. But here's what takes place. Starting in verse 24 of chapter 20 of the Gospel of John, it says this. But Thomas, one of the 12, called Didymus, which just means twin. So he had a twin, but that's all we know. Was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples were saying to him, "We've seen the Lord." But he said, "Unless I see in his hands, the imprints of the nails, and if I put my finger in the place of nails, and if I put my hands in his side, I will not believe." Well, after 8 days, the disciples were again inside, and Thomas with them. Then Jesus came. The doors having been shut, stood in their midst and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Reach here with your finger and see my hands, and reach here with your hands and put them in my side, and do not be unbelieving, but believing." And Thomas answered and said to them, "My Lord, my God." Jesus brings home an interesting point that we'll look at in a little bit. "Because you have seen me and you believed, blessed are those who do not see but yet believe." That's us today that we want to look at. Join with me as we pray. Father, in the few moments we have this morning on this Easter Sunday morning at Village Parkway Baptist Church here in San Antonio, we gather to celebrate the unbelievable truth that Jesus Christ is alive. Speak to us today of what it means and how it impacts our lives as we live each day. Now watch over and guide us. It's my prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. You know, if I was going to make a movie of the resurrection, it would be a dramatic morning with everything spectacular unfolding and the disciples instantly figuring it out and everybody in place within an hour after it happened and marching forward in life in the most dramatic of ways. But if I did that, it'd be fiction because that's not what unfolded. And what we got to realize is the cruelty in which he died, the horribleness in which he looked, the abandonment by the disciples themselves, knowing the emotion of men like this, were broken men. Men who said, even Thomas said it earlier, "We will die with you." Peter said it most profoundly, but they had all said we would be there. And when that moment came of courage and opportunity for these men to stand with him, they melted under the heat of the moment. Like butter in an oven, they were gone. Now, I want you to know something. A man doesn't get over that. When he chokes at the moment he's supposed to be courageous, he very rarely will ever recover from that particular moment. For God created men for moments like that to stand firm and protect family, friends, and those around him. And they folded. When it said Peter wept, we're talking a tough man, calloused hands from handling the nets in his fishing boat, from working the Sea of Galilee in the sun with probably leathered skin and everything else from all that he had ever done. A man who had bravery and boldness and impetuousness about him, he melts into weeping. It's the same word that was used whenever Jesus wept when Lazarus died. He is totally broken. And on this Sunday morning, as you got up this morning, and some of you early this morning, because I was up, already were texting Happy Easter and pictures of resurrection and everything else all over the internet and Facebook and everything else this morning. When the disciples got up, they are not slept well. They are probably tired, and they have had it, and they are worn out, and life is over, and they are scared to death. Make that real, because you don't recover from moments like this. This is war at its worst, and they lost. We know what began to unfold. Some of the ladies, Mary Magdalene, one of them, go to the tomb. There's nothing there. There's a young man sitting there in white. He said, "He's not here. He's gone." She steps out. We know from another gospel that there is a confrontation with Jesus. She goes running as fast as she can. I don't know if they were in the upper room or they're just in a house hiding, but wherever they were, she finds them and she walks into there and says, "He's alive." And you know what the disciples did? High-fived each other and says, "We got this. It's over with. Let's go conquer the world." No. They never saw this coming. That's what's amazing to me. They never saw this coming. They never really figured anything out. In Mark 8:31, when we started at Caesarea Philippi, he told them, the Son of Man will be killed, and in 3 days, he'll be resurrected. In Mark 9, after the transfiguration, we picked all these sermons for a reason, because these are critical moments in which Jesus is telling them again, don't speak of my transfiguration until the Son of Man raises from the dead. And if you didn't catch the first time at Caesarea Philippi, after the transfiguration, that cemented in your head. But then later, Mark will record that Jesus sat there and he would teach them. It's imperfect tense, which means he taught them over and over and over in the days that were remaining that he would be killed and rise 3 days. But they're crushed when he dies. And they don't anticipate anything. Resurrection was far from their mind. And in Mark 9:14, he appeared to disciples. Mark records that he reproached them for their unbelief and hardness of heart because they did not believe those who had seen him after he had risen. Matthew records they were doubtful at that particular point when they first heard. Luke records them as thinking it was nonsense. So I'd like to say the disciples on Easter Sunday morning when they first heard got all excited, jumped up and down, screaming like little kids about how great this victory was, but it wasn't there. We can give Thomas a hard time, but these guys were just like Thomas. So what brought about the transformation of the ten? Well, earlier in John, if we had read that particular part, Jesus appeared to them in the upper room. And what did he tell them? Take your hands, touch me. Put your hand right here. They must have done that because John will record in 1 John that we touched him. We beheld him. We saw him. They did that. And so what then happened was they later together with Thomas, and the Bible says that they kept telling Thomas, he's alive. We've seen him. We've touched him. We've done all of this. We saw the nails in his hand, the imprint within his thighs. And it's in the imperfect tense, which means these guys were so giddy by now that that's all they're talking about. And Thomas goes, no. Until I touch him, I will not believe. I will not have anything to do with this whatsoever. It is not going to happen. I don't give him a hard time because that's where all of them were. And that's where most of the world is this Easter Sunday morning. Unless you do some dramatic thing, I'm not going to follow it. So what brought about Thomas's change? Well, it's 8 days. He is in the room with the disciples. The doors are shut, and suddenly Christ appears. Jesus says the exact same thing he said the first time he showed up to the other disciples. Peace be with you. He then says the next thing that he said before. Put your hands, touch me, see that I am real. What was his response? Have you ever stood at the grave, the casket of your loved ones with the casket open? September 11th, 2:00 afternoon, before everybody started showing up that evening, we opened the casket of my sister who had committed suicide on her 17th birthday. We really didn't know if we wanted to do that or not because she'd taken a rifle and put it to her forehead, pulled the trigger, but they promised us that they had done a good job in fixing her up. I'll never forget the moment. As I stood there looking at my sister, I had all kinds of emotions at that particular moment. Crushed, but angry. Tammy, how could you have done this? Wondering what could I have done to have stopped it? You can never guess what your emotions are at moments like that because they are just all over the charts. Turn and see mom and dad standing there crushed after pouring their heart and soul into trying to save this young girl that we never could save. I remember I never said a word out loud, but I'm talking to her. Why'd you do this? Why didn't you give me another chance? Why didn't you call that Monday? I was getting ready to call you. Why didn't you call me? I missed calling her by an hour. It was on my schedule as soon as I finished the meeting to call her because her birthday was that day. I want you to know something. If I'd had the power that day to put life in that little girl and get her back up and give it one more shot, I'd have done it. And if she had suddenly opened her eyes and looked at me, we'd have screamed and hollered and jumped up and down and hugged and everything else like you can't imagine. Life would have never been the same if we could have pulled a moment off like that. But in reality, we can't. We're so helpless at moments like that. There is absolutely nothing you and I can do. And at that moment, when Thomas sees standing in front of him, Jesus Christ, he got to experience a moment that none of us will experience until Christ comes in all of his glory. He got to see the resurrection and the Lord Jesus in all of his glory at that particular moment. And guys, when you and I have been given the privilege of understanding this day who Jesus Christ is, we only have two responses. My Lord. Notice you start with Lord. Why? Because he's the one who's in control of this old world. He is King of Kings. He is Lord of Lords. He's the one who created it. He's the one who sustains it. He's the one who's going to bring it to finish. And he's the one who rules. When you make the confession on Easter Sunday morning, my Lord, it means this too. I'm going to do what you tell me to do. I'm going to live my life for you. I'm going to follow what you teach. I'm going to live my life in such a way that brings you honor and glory. Now, I know we live in a day in which people say, well, that's good. That's your truth, but I have my truth. Well, I want you to know something. It doesn't determine what you think is right and what is truthful. It determines by who is truth. And Jesus is truth. And he died. He was resurrected. And he sits at the right hand throne of the Father. And no matter how you feel about what you believe, he's the one who controls what's happening. And he's coming again. The rest of the world can believe what they want to, but they're going to hit a wall one day and they're going to regret it. There is only one name that you bow down before. There is only one name that you make a confession. And that is Jesus Christ, the Son of God. And Thomas that day said, my Lord. And then he said, my God. Jesus Christ was God who became man. He came down here and took on flesh and blood so that he would understand who you are and what you walk through. He suffered and he bled and he died because our hearts are broken. I know Netflix has a thing running around right now that everybody's going to. It's 13 Reasons Why. Not for children. Not even close. Topic, okay, but it is not done in a way that will teach good. That movie or that series betrays the brokenness of the human heart. I've watched a little of it. Reminded me of my high school days. I was the brunt. When you're 5'4", weigh 120, and you play athletics, I was the brunt of all the jokes. And many of them I can't even tell you from the pulpit because they're too embarrassing, the stuff we go through. So I did understand that. But the one thing and the little bit I watched showed me this. People are broken. People can be downright mean and can be evil. Jesus Christ came into this old world because that's the way we all were. And he came and he allowed himself to be broken and he allowed himself to suffer so that you could be healed. And guys, when you come to faith in this one who died for you, it brings about a change. Life's not easy. Overcoming much of what's wrong in this world is never easy. And the evil that you and I encounter with people, sometimes within family or friends or work, are not easy to overcome. But he says we are overcomers in him, and we have victory through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And I'm able to overcome the world because I'm not going to worry about what the world thinks. I worry about what he wants, and I walk with him. Why? Because he's alive, and he lives. We this day serve a risen Savior, and it should have a dramatic, unbelievable impact on how you live. Now, I want to conclude this way. Where do you turn to learn about the resurrection? We're not doing it today, but what book of the Bible do you turn to really learn about the resurrection? You turn to 1 Corinthians. He's dealing with a very messed up culture. And they don't fully grasp and understand. The Greeks do not understand a resurrection at all. It ran counter to everything they believed. And in 1 Corinthians 15, Paul unfolds an entire chapter on this resurrection. And he even tells us who all got to see him. He talks about everyone. And there was even a group of 500. Paul even was given privilege to be able to see Christ. I think one of the great meetings had to be when James, his brother, saw him and that encounter that took place. James became the leader of the church of Jerusalem. And then he unfolds at the very end, after he explains all that's involved and what it means to us and how it'll affect our lives, he then tells us how to live. Now, before I read that, does anybody know whatever happened to Thomas? We hear about him in Acts at the very start, and then we hear nothing more about him. But we do know. When you see the horrible things going on in Syria right now, and hear of the horrible things that happened to Christians in Syria, who started the church in Syria many, many centuries ago? Thomas did. Thomas went to Syria, and Christianity thrived in Syria for millennia. You know where he went next? Ever heard of a country called Iran? We had Ayman Amani here Tuesday night from Iran. He's a believer now, raised Muslim. He's come to Christ. Did you know the greatest revival going on in the Middle East is in Iran right now, that believers are coming to Christ in the most dramatic of ways? Do you realize that the radical Muslims who run Iran are just a small minority, and they're the ones who stole the country from the Persians? And the Persians can't stomach them. But out of all of that, there's been an amazing revival. Do you know that recently when America released the billions of dollars because of negotiations that took place, that money was used to put secret people into the churches? And since that day, many have been dying and giving their lives because of their faith in Christ in Iran, because America released all those billions of dollars. But they are standing faithful and not backing off. Do you know who brought the gospel to Iran? Thomas. He's one of their great heroes, the pastor said Tuesday. You know where else Thomas went? This is what he's known for. He went to India. You know, when you talk of Nehemiah, you have two things that symbolize Nehemiah. Does anybody know what they are? The sword and the trowel. Sword and the trowel. Well, with Thomas, he's known for a spear. Now, the sword for Nehemiah was so that you could protect the wall while they were building it. But the spear was because that's how Thomas died. Supposedly, they still have the spear. Who knows? They've probably got about 20 of those spears now. But he's known for the spear and the builder's square. Just like Nehemiah was. Why? Because he built everywhere he ever went. He impacted the culture everywhere he went. Thomas is not the same man ever again. He is a man who loved greatly, loved deeply, and who spread throughout the world the truth of who Christ was. And to this day, he's reverenced in Syria. To this day, he is reverenced in Iran. To this day, he is reverenced in India because of his faith being so strong. So what are you and I called to do this day? Well, Paul's going to say in 1 Corinthians 15:58, because the resurrection is true, because you and I one day will be resurrected, he says this, therefore, my beloved brethren, be steadfast. You know what that means? Stay under the pressure no matter what happens in life. I am not going to fold to that which goes on around me, but I will keep my feet firmly planted because I'm built upon a foundation. What's the foundation that you and I are built upon? The prophets, the apostles, Christ being the cornerstone, Ephesians 2. We literally have a strong foundation upon which to stand, and the Lord is building his church on that, and you and I are part of that building. We're part of the stones in that building. And you and I are called that no matter what happens in life, I stand firm. Now, I'll be in Cuba here soon. I'm taking my grandson with me to Cuba along with Alejandro, where we'll be heading down there. I love to be among the Cuban Christians because they've learned this steadfastness after 50 years of persecution. They have learned what it is to keep walking no matter what goes wrong. Why do they do that? Because they believe in the resurrection of Christ Jesus. And they believe that they too will be resurrected one day. And they believe that the most important thing in life is to do what? Make certain the Father in heaven is pleased. And so there is steadfastness. The second thing that Paul says that should be in your life is you'll be immovable. You're not moving me out wherever he's placed me in my life. I am immovable when it comes to the truth. You say, well, you're hard-headed. Well, maybe that's true, but I know something. I know whom I believe. And I am persuaded that he is able to guard that which I've entrusted to him. But not only me, but all who love him. See, you and I will not be shaken from the fact that we know something. He is alive. We believe that deeply within our hearts. God has allowed us the privilege of seeing and understanding that. And our confession is, my Lord, my God. And so because of that, nothing will move me. You know what the third thing is? If I'm steadfast and immovable, then I'm going to do something. And you know what that is? Paul says, always abounding in the work of our Lord. Always overboard doing that which he's called. So what's the work of the Lord this day? Love your family. Be there for your kids and your grandkids. Live a very moral life in a very immoral country. Stand for truth. Be a good employer or employee at work. Do your job. Worship in your church. Fellowship with believers. Just do the work of the Lord. See, the work of the Lord is everything we do. The work of the Lord is not being a preacher. The work of the Lord can be a teacher. The work of the Lord can be a military guy. The work of the Lord can be a businessman. The work of the Lord can be retired. It's just living our lives every day, bringing him honor and glory because he's given me the greatest gift there ever was. But I like the last thing he says in chapter 15. Your toil, your work will never be in vain. Will never be in vain. Doing good always works. And most people don't believe that. Most say, I tried doing good, it didn't work. No, you didn't do it long enough. You didn't stay faithful long enough. You know, watch the Spurs last night. It didn't start well. They hadn't been playing well, and it did not start well. And I went, oh, we lose to Memphis the first game. You're a 70% chance you're out the first round. I'm glad I didn't quit the first quarter. I hung in with them. Wasn't real thrilled at halftime, but I'm still hanging in there with them. Love the third quarter. See, too often we quit in the first quarter when things don't get right. But hold it. What do we believe? He's alive. He sits at the right-hand throne of the Father. He's coming again. One day there will be a trumpet sound. There will be the voice of an archangel shout. And the dead in Christ will rise. We will be resurrected with him. Do you realize how big we win in life? It is the most dramatic win ever. It's not a last-second shot at the buzzer. It's not a last-second home run over the fence. It's not a last-second touchdown catch to win a game. No, we win 100-0. Jesus Christ won when he died on the cross, and he won when the Father raised him from the dead, and we will win with him when he comes in all of his glory. So you and I every day do what? We stay steadfast. Not, we're immovable. We go about our lives serving and doing what he's called us to do, knowing that one day he's going to go, good job. Texas terms, good job. Biblical terms, well done, thou good and faithful servant. That's too much. I just like good job with a thumbs up. Good job. We finished our porch this week. It's been a 2-year project. We painted it last night. Glad we got it done before the rain hit a minute ago. And this evening, we'll put the furniture on the deck and start. We've been enjoying it, but we will really enjoy the finished product. There's something about as you get to be the age that I am that you get to sit there sometimes with a cup of coffee and you look back over life. Been doing this a long time now. When I came, my hair was totally black 25 years ago. I had a thick, thick mustache, and I was about 40 pounds less than what I am right now. Y'all about wore me out after all of these years. But you want to know something? When you stop and think about your life and what you've done, where you've been, I am so grateful because of my simple faith in my Lord and the promise of His Word that every day I just got up and did what He asked me to do. I got up, went to work. I loved Jen. I did my best to raise the children, try to pay her bills. Showed up every single time I was supposed to show up. Just stay at it over and over. Through the good times, through the bad times. Through the scary times when cancer with Jen or the kids being hurt when they were young and wondering if they'd even survive the accidents they were walking through. Being covered in the blood of my kids on two different occasions in ambulances sprinting to emergency rooms 30 miles away. But always just showing up every single day. And so this morning, as I open up Facebook, Stephanie had already posted their picture. They were going to church early this morning for early service. And there are six of the grandkids there in the picture. And I'm going, it's been worth every moment to be here right now. But I didn't quit somewhere in the past. Do you realize that if I have any time before 1994 folded under the pressure of life, or even after 1994 when I came here, folded under the pressure of the job, Stephanie would have never met Troy sitting on this side over here, and never would that relationship have blossomed the way it did, and then to have six grandkids. See, what you and I don't realize is, you know, I would like you to be so emotionally excited when it comes to the resurrection. You walk out of here pumped up like you do at the end of a Spurs game. But you know what I really want you to do? I want you to walk out of here with this deep resolve. I'm going to walk home this day, and I know something. He's alive. And because He is, I live. And I walk through wherever You want me to go, Lord, and I'll do, because You're my Lord. I'll do what You ask me to do. And I'll walk through the hardships of our lives. And I'm going to go through this thing, because when you start getting towards the end of it, you look back and you see something. He was always faithful. His promises are true. And you get to reap the rewards of those moments. I will tell you that sitting on the back porch, drinking on the new porch with a cup of coffee, that coffee tastes a little bit better. Not because of my Keurig, but because life has worked well. And no matter where God takes us in the days that follow, whether He was to call me home this afternoon and life changed dramatically for my family, no matter what may happen, He's still alive and He's still in control. And He's just calling us, you be faithful no matter where I lead you. And guys, we close with this. When that day comes and that trumpet sounds and the voice of the archangel shouts, and we get caught up in the air, you want to see excitement then? You and I will see each other in the air and we're going to go, we made it. Some of you will be looking around and say, I can't believe he made it. But we will have made it. We will be with Him. We will be with Him. So everything we walk through right now, we have the strength and the ability to do it because He's alive. And He's made a promise He's going to get us safely to the finish. Now, He's with you guys. You don't quit on Him because He does not quit on you. And you live a good life for Him. And you bring Him glory this day. You know what Easter will be like this afternoon? Go have a good meal with your family. Hunt your Easter eggs or whatever you do. Some of you are a little too old for that. But just go have a good afternoon. Take a good nap. Some of you need to rest a little bit. But just enjoy the day, because you know something that most in the world do not know. He's alive. He's alive, guys. We serve a risen Savior. He's alive. Father, we thank you for the day and for the privilege and honor you give us to study your word. Lord, we thank you for Easter. We thank you for every Sunday, but Easter is such a time to stop and to center on the critical truths of life and how it impacts life. This morning we saw the impact on Thomas and the disciples and what it did to them. They didn't come easy into this. It was a struggle beyond imagination from where they were at to where they came. But when they knew that you were alive, it impacted how the men live. Now, Scripture tells us, Lord, that we're more blessed when we do not see, but we believe. We didn't get to be there that day. We did not get to see what the disciples saw, but they have given this testimony of all that's involved. But may each one in this room know this day that your blessings are upon them because they believe that Jesus Christ is the way, the truth, and the life. We believe that no man comes to the Father but through Christ. And we believe that He is Lord and that He has risen from the dead. Thank you, Father, for the blessings that you bestow upon each one of us. It is my prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to sing a verse or two of invitation, and Doug and I are available down front. And if you've never made a confession that Jesus Christ is alive and is Lord, come talk with us this morning. Let's stand. The band leads, we sing. And you come if God directs. You come.
Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to Him belong, they are weak, but He is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me.
Been singing that song since we've been little kids, but it's still important. It still says what it's all about. And you walk out of here in a moment knowing how much you're loved through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Give me a few of the announcements up real quick. We move the announcements. That's not an announcement. Oh, it is. I don't want the video. Skip the video. We ain't got time for that. 7 o'clock this Friday, The Case for Christ. That is worth seeing that movie. You'd have seen the video if I'd let you. If not, Google it, YouTube it. It's a good video. And then call the office or in the back, buy tickets. $10. We've rented a theater. It's worth seeing the movie. It's a spectacular true story of how a man who did not believe in Christianity went to disprove it to get his wife all messed up, and he met Christ. And so you want to see that. A couple others, our mission, if you haven't given to our home mission offering, we got one more week left in that. Hit me another one. Ladies have their Daughter of the King on April 29th. The sign-up's out back there, ladies. Join us for that special. And then men, we have a men's night. Bring your shotguns. We got skeet shooting going on. Bring you a steak. We'll provide you all the fixings, and we'll have a great time. We'll try not to shoot each other, but we'll have a good time of doing that. You sign up for that. We don't need your money, but we do need to know how many are coming so we know what all to provide for. Sign up in the foyer afterwards. And then silent auction ends today. We've been raising money through the school. The baskets are still over there. You want to check, see if you've got the winning auction so far. If not, you want to double whatever you see and give into the school. They would greatly appreciate that. All right. And their prayer probably still for our military guys in the back. There were over 400 this morning. Grab you some prayer concerns of our military guys who are serving this Easter out at Lackland, and you pray for them. Lead us in our benediction, and you have a great day as you celebrate the resurrection of Christ.
You are dismissed to Sunday school.